Now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
All right, everyone, it's 2 o'clock. Let's get started. My name is Rob Altamont, and I'll be your moderator for today's Heurika webinar titled The Basics of Gripping and Regripping. The webinar will be led by Heurika's Technical Director, Jeff Summit. Let me give you a few words about Jeff's background. Jeff has worked in all facets of club making and repair since 1984 and has devoted the past 20 years to researching, testing, and analyzing thousands of different golf shafts. He has compiled his findings and research into the Dynamic Shaft Fitting Index, which is featured in the best-selling book of The Modern Guide to Club Making and Total Club Fitting in the 21st Century. Additionally, he has authored the annual Dynamic Shaft Fitting Addendum, which instructs club fitters in the proper fitting and selection of shafts. Both books are available for sale online at our website, heurikagolf.com. Let me get a few housekeeping items out of the way first. Your audio settings are muted, which means we cannot hear you. And if you have any questions, use the question box located in the upper right-hand corner of your dashboard. If for any reason you must leave the webinar, don't worry. It is being recorded and will be on youtube.com/heurikagolf in about an hour. It's also going to be on our blog. With that, I'd like to turn it over to Heurika Golf Technical Director Jeff Summit. And take it away, Jeff.
Thank you, Rob, and thank all of you for taking the time today to attend the webinar on gripping and regripping. If you attended our last webinar, we discussed epoxies and how to properly mix, measure, and apply the right amount to avoid potential breakage and reduce waste. Unlike some of our other webinars, this one on the basics of gripping and regripping is not necessarily in the sequential order of the assembly process. The reason being is many individuals are first exposed to club making by regripping their own clubs with relatively little tools, tongs. Someone can rejuvenate their existing clubs and help lower their score. It's been proven that worn or slick grips can cost you valuable strokes. Think of it the same way as putting new tires on your car when the tread becomes bald and unsafe to drive. Just like new tires, not only do you get peace of mind, but better performance. Golf grips are made of materials that age and wear over time. They naturally degrade from the exposure to heat and sunlight, as well as the dirt and oils from your hands. While proper cleaning can prolong the life of a grip, there's only so long that they can last. Softer grips, such as those made from polyurethane, will tend to wear quicker than rubber grips, while the more expensive corded models will last the longest. Avid golfers will regrip their clubs at the beginning of each year, while others may elect to regrip every 2 to 3 years based upon the amount of play. Any club making and repair shop offers regripping as one of their basic services, and usually the going rate is $3.50 per grip just for the labor plus the cost of the grip. If you're looking at regripping 14 of your clubs, the labor alone tallies $49. This is why many individuals elect to do the job themselves if they consider themselves even somewhat handy. Now, grips can range anywhere from 79 cents, like Heurika's house brand Karma grips, to some corded models that are approaching $8 each, while the average grip is in the $3 to $3.50 range. The very basic supplies can be acquired for around $10. So when you consider what the average golfer invests in their clubs, new grips are a relatively inexpensive proposition. Now, this webinar will go over how to properly regrip a club and provide the basic knowledge to properly install a new grip. We won't get into the more complicated subject on understanding grip sizing charts until another webinar. Regripping, well, requires one to remove an existing grip, hence the name. Believe me, there's a right way and a wrong way to do it. The method I want to teach today could be laid out in 4 steps: clamp, cut, heat, and peel. Now, I've witnessed many different techniques over the years, some of which I want to pass on, which I feel are the easiest and safest methods to remove a grip and protect the shaft. One of my fellow colleagues used what I would refer to as the West Virginia method, named on the general location he came from. He could remove the grip and install a new one without the use of a vise and somehow get the grip on straight each and every time. He adapted a procedure that worked based on the space, or lack thereof, which happened to be his college dorm room. While he was very efficient through lots of practice, I certainly tell those starting out to use a vise, as this will make things much easier. Not only will you need a vise, which you can usually get locally and dirt cheap, but you can also get a small vise clamp to protect the shaft. Hariko sells a vinyl shaft clamp for $1.75, and that's going to last a very long time. First, you want to slip the vinyl shaft clamp over the shaft and then inside the jaws of your vise, just a couple inches below the grip. You'll want to clamp tight enough where the shaft's not going to slip, but avoid clamping so tightly that you're going to crack the shaft, as in the case of the very thin-walled graphite shafts and even some of today's real thin-walled steel shafts. Just so you know, manufacturers will not warrant shafts that are defective due to excessive clamping pressure. In those cases, not only will you need to re-grip the club, but now you're going to need the much more costly reshafting job to do as well. Once the shaft is safely clamped, we're on to our next step. Now the second step involves cutting the grip off. By far the safest method utilizes a hook knife blade. These can be obtained at your local home improvement or hardware store and fit a number of utility knives. Most likely you're going to have to buy a minimum of a pack of five, but they're only like $5 for the pack, so it won't break the bank. Plus you can use them elsewhere around the shop or the home. When you go to cut off the grip, don't cut the very back or the bottom of the grip. Why, you ask? Well, we'll explain this when we get into the grip's anatomy later on, but the grip may have an internal rib where it's thicker than the rest of the grip, and it's just easier to cut through the path of least resistance. You want to start out by, you want to put your hook, the hook part of the knife blade starting at the mouth or the small end of the grip, and pull along the length of the grip. You may have to draw the knife blade through the same slit a couple of times depending on how old or thick the grip is or how dull your blade is. Speaking of which, if you get old grips to be removed, you know, the ones that appear to be vulcanized onto the shaft, then removal will be much more time consuming. Instead of simply cutting the grip off with the hook knife blade, you may actually have to scrape it off with a heavy-duty knife blade. Chances are, if the grip is that dry rotted, it'll be attached to a steel shaft where you're not going to have fear of damaging the shaft with the knife blade that you would with a graphite shaft. If you're deciding to do a lot of volume regripping, you can use something a little bit more heavy-duty than a hook knife blade in your utility knife. We offer something called the Grip Rip, where you slip the grip inside the device and then just simply pull the club. The blade is hidden inside the grip rip for your safety, and you get the extra leverage of grabbing onto the head. You'll still need to peel the grip off, but a good chunk will already be removed with the extra large blade, and these run about $110. Now, once the grip is cut with the knife, you want to grab what you can at the mouth of the grip and start to peel it back away from the shaft. Oftentimes, the entire grip will come right off.